Sorry about that. I'm reading Many Lifetimes. It's a collaboration between Dennis Kelsey and Joan Marshall Grant. They were both hypnotherapists, and Joan Marshall Grant was also a seer and a psychic. And this is now chapter 6, which is again by Dennis Kelsey. They're taking turns. I just finished Joan's account. And here is a reincarnation and psychotherapy by Dennis Kelsey. I had always been appalled by the length of time an orthodox psychoanalysis was presumed to require. And one appeal of hypnosis had been that, with its aid, a radical form of therapy could be accomplished far more quickly. I completely accepted Joan's concept of the vastly increased time scale during which the events responsible for a patient's illness might have occurred, and I found it extremely exciting. But I was apprehensive that the task of searching for the essential experience in this virtually limitless area might be endless. Joan assured me that she was well aware that some patients would seize on the notion of reincarnation as the new avenue of escape. But she felt confident of being able to discriminate between a genuine recall from an earlier lifetime and an alleged memory, which in fact was only a fantasy in fancy dress. She emphasized that in the majority of cases, the cause of the neurosis would lie in events of the current lifetime, that only when fragments of an earlier personality had failed to integrate would the proposed extension of my usual regression technique become opposite. We had scarcely established ourselves in London when two such cases occurred in quick succession. They were particularly impressive to me because each was a former patient on whom, long before I had even heard of Joan, I had carried out an extensive hypnoanalysis with which had been only partially successful. The first was a young man with an obsessional neurosis. His most prominent symptom was the unshakable idea that an action he had performed when a boy of 7 was responsible for the arthritis, which his father developed some 13 years later. The incident had happened when his parents, who had been away for a few days, were due to return, and his nanny had asked him to help her to make their bed. She had gone to fetch the sheets when it occurred to him to run a damp flannel over the mattress, a task he had completed before she re-entered the room. He knew that to associate this incident with his father's illness was completely illogical, but this in no way diminished his feelings of guilt and anxiety. And as so frequently happens in this obsessional type of illness, the mechanism responsible for his principal symptom had spread to various other aspects of his life and created a number of subsidiary problems. The analysis went into many ramifications, which it is unnecessary to consider here, but I must mention certain factors which concern the central symptom. According to a theory which at that time I considered basic, every small boy goes through a phase of feeling violently hostile towards his father. If this hostility, instead of being resolved, is relegated to the child's unconscious, it may later be the source of a wide variety of neurotic feelings. I assumed this was what had happened in this case. And when I learned during an early session, it was axiomatic in his family that to sleep in a damp bed meant catching your death of cold or resulted in rheumatism. I felt sure that in running a damp flannel over the mattress, the child had been acting out an unconscious wish to kill his father. I no longer believe that it is natural for small boys to go through this hostile phase, but this patient had undoubtedly done so. To his astonishment and dismay, he found a plethora of such feelings and a number of acts for which they had found symbolical expression. But to my surprise, the damn flannel episode did not appear to come under this heading. Though I returned to the point repeatedly, and the patient appreciated how apt an explanation it would be, it had no effect on his obsession. After about 80 sessions, it became clear that we were making no further progress. We mutually agreed to discontinue the analysis. I heard from him occasionally. I knew that his symptoms waxed and waned, but were not preventing him making excellent progress in his career. I had had no news of him for 2 years when a letter arrived asking for an appointment as soon as possible. He wrote that a few months previously his father had died of a stroke. This event had caused no exasperation of my patient's symptoms until he had chanced upon an article in a magazine which mentioned that if rats were exposed for long enough to cold and damp, they suffered a rise in blood pressure. This information had sparked off the chain of ideas. Cold, damp, high blood pressure, stroke. And now he felt that not only his father's arthritis, but his death also was inexorably linked to the episode of the damp mattress. When he arrived, I gave him a brief resume of my reasons for believing that the origin of his symptom might lie in an earlier lifetime. He found the theory acceptable and readily agreed that Joan should be present during the session. Within minutes of reaching deep hypnosis, he said, "I can see a young woman in an Edwardian dress. She's wearing a wide-brimmed hat tied on with a veil. She's standing on the steps outside the front door, waiting to be taken out in the motor car, which she is hoping to see come up the drive heading to the house. It is a large mansion." At this point, Joan passed me the notebook by which she communicates with me during a session. As even a low whisper can be disturbing to the patient, I read, "Valid memory, I can see it too, but not a mansion, an ordinary late Victorian house. Ask him, how many windows?" I did so. He replied, "There are two on each side of the front door, which has four steps leading up to it. There are five windows in the upper story." Then he added, "I can see the drive clearly now. It is only a gravel sweep around a shrubbery of laurels." During the next hour, the story gradually unfolded. The young woman had been orphaned during her early teens when her parents died during a cholera epidemic in India. My father was in the army and my mother had always been delicate. She had been sent back to England to live with her aunt, her mother's elder sister. The house was on the outskirts of a country town, which the patient thought was in East Anglia, but he could not remember the name of it. She imagined herself to be financially dependent on her aunt until recently. At the age of 21, she had been told by a lawyer that her parents had left her a substantial trust fund. Until she married, the interest was controlled by the aunt, but on her marriage, the capital would become her own, providing, and this was the crux of the problem, that the marriage took place with her aunt's consent. If she married someone considered undesirable, she would not get a penny of it. The patient became increasingly emotional as he described how the girl hoped to marry the curate, whom the aunt did not consider a suitable match. Perhaps the curate was too timid or too avaricious to agree to an elopement, but it became obvious that the girl was becoming desperate with a fear of losing him. At this stage, Joan handed me another note. "Tell him to see his aunt's bedroom." He soon began to describe a room which was obviously the lair of a professional invalid. "It is intolerably stuffy. She has been burning one of her medical cones and she never permits a window to be opened. There are medicine bottles and pill boxes everywhere." Another note from Joan asked what the aunt is doing. The immediate response to this question was, "She's having a bath. It has mahogany sides and there is a step up to it." I asked him what he was doing. He replied, "I'm making her bed while she's in the bath, but I do not get the sheets from the airing cupboard. I bring them from the clothesline in the garden." At this point, Joan, unseen by the patient whose eyes remained closed while under hypnosis, made the gesture of dipping her hand in water and flicking the drops from her fingers. But before I could ask him for further details, he continued, "The sheets are damp, but not damp enough. I go to the washstand to fetch the ewer and flick water over the mattress. But the aunt came back from the bathroom too soon. She not only saw that what the girl was doing, but understood why she was doing it. She screamed, 'You want me to catch my death of cold,' and fell into such a frenzy of rage that she had a stroke. From this, she remained bedridden for many years, nursed by the girl, who dared not leave her because the aunt now had the additional weapon of a threat to expose the attempt at murder. When I brought the patient slowly back to the present day and out of the hypnosis, he had a clear memory of all he had been telling us and felt no doubt at all that it was a part of his own long history. He was completely satisfied that at last he had discovered the true source of his guilt, a guilt which had become transferred to his father. When I wrote to him for permission to quote him this case history, he confirmed that this symptom had never recurred after this session." So that was the first case, and I stopped this here at the first reading.